Now, I recently joined a media delegation to Japan to learn more about their energy challenges and best practices and what the Philippines can learn. We got a chance to sit down with Aboitiz Power's Thermal Group COO, Lino Bernardo. Aboitiz Power is, of course, a partner of Japanese energy giant JERA. Here's that interview. The government has set a target of 50% renewables by 2040. The Aboitiz Group is going to do that 10 years faster, 2030. Are you on track?
I would say so, yes. We are on track towards building that 3,600 megawatt of additional RE capacity. There are challenges, and I believe the team today that we have is geared towards addressing those challenges. No? So those who are following the energy market has heard of slow transition. We have been transitioning, no, since time immemorial. So this is another transition that we're going through, albeit a little bit faster than before, but thermal will always be there. One, for simple reasons. One, we, the country like ours, no, we really need inexpensive, reliable, secure source of electricity. So baseload thermal currently still offers that solution, no? Better than the others. And the newer technologies, while they are there, are also facing challenges, no? So thermal will be here to make sure that that transition happens in a economical and secure way. And second, with renewables, with the growth of renewables, all the more reason you need rotating machines to balance the grid. So thermal will be here for quite some time, but definitely we need to encourage build of renewables, but at the same time we need to make sure that thermal remains efficient, available and reliable.
I wonder how much easier has it become to be in this business of energy with all of these green transition ambitions, not just by private companies, but by countries?
I would say it's one dimension, no? The push for greener sources of electricity. But I'd say there are other factors, or there are other pressure points. No? So, the pressure on commodity, geopolitical uncertainty. So with what happened in Ukraine has given us that additional set of information that sources of electricity, or the fuel that we are using for our electricity, need to be secure. So you cannot be dependent on one type of source of fuel, right? You have to diversify. That's why you need renewables, using indigenous resources. You still need coal. LNG is, of course, a very important fuel, and so forth, right? So you need to diversify to make sure that you have a secure source of electricity.
How should Filipinos make sense of our power situation today? I mean, every summer we get this warning, you know, conserve energy, red alerts, every summer. It's like we don't learn the lesson.
Right. That's a good question, Mimi. We only realize, or rather, we think about electricity whenever there is an outage. Right, or when prices are going up, and that's normal because it's ubiquitous. No, you turn on the switch, electricity is there. You don't think much about it, no, unless it's out or prices are soaring up. So the thing is, it requires good planning from both the government and the private investors. We need to make sure that we are building enough capacity, that we are building a balance. Balanced mix, no? For our electricity capacity. It needs also the good implementation or execution of the developers, making sure that it gets delivered on time at the most economical way. So it's very difficult to explain it to our end consumers, right? But that's what really is needed to be done, no? Long-term planning, right? The government sending the right signals to the private investors on the energy mix requirement, on where it's going. And of course, all the efforts of private investors to invest, right? Invest in our energy sector to make sure that there is enough capacity. Energy equals prosperity.
And when do you see that future coming? I was surprised. I found out Japan also has the same problem. During peak season, they also tell people to not use electricity. A first world country like Japan also having energy shortages.
Yeah, just as a quick comment on Japan, no? Because they're quite challenged because they don't have that kind of resource. They don't have natural gas. They don't have coal, right? Well, there is a lot of sun during certain times of the year. There's not enough space, no? So RE is also a challenge. So they probably can only rely on offshore wind for renewables and some solar. So so in a way, Japan is a good example, no? Of a country who's trying to plan ahead, but they're still getting caught with this sudden increases or upsurge in demand or shortage in commodity availability.
So I think what the impression we're getting is that Japan is serving as a blueprint for how the Philippines can plan ahead, which leads me to your partnership with JERA. This partnership looks like a match made in heaven. How do you envision this partnership growing in the next decades? It's a long-term bet.
I think, by the way, yes, it's a good match. We're very happy with our relationships with JERA. And their experience, no, their long experience and wide and deep experience in LNG will help Aboitiz Power and hopefully the whole Philippines, no, to make sure that we have access to that resource and the technology. And further down the road, we see expansion in more facilities, LNG to power, but more than that, also in renewables and of course storage, energy storage. Those are the emerging technologies that we're seeing that we will benefit from our cooperation with JERA.
When will your LNG ambitions come to life for Aboitiz Power?
We are aiming to build our LNG project by 2029-2030, so that's the time frame. So today we're looking at various options and configurations with the end in mind of making sure that we have the most economical configuration to serve the Filipino people.
LNG sounds very foreign to many Filipinos, and you're an engineer. Maybe why don't you give us a 60-second explanation of how LNG works? It's a natural gas. Fossil fuel still.
It's still fossil fuel, but half of coal's carbon, mm-hmm. Right? So it's natural gas that gets liquefied because you have to liquefy it for transport. So it gets shipped to various countries, and then once it arrives in the receiving country, it gets gasified. It's regasified to be used in the power plant. So it's an abundant fuel. But the thing is, shipping it is quite a challenge because you have to liquefy it and bring it to as low as 161 degrees. Celsius negative, right? To make it liquid, to make sure that
to condense
the volume
or shrink it.
Yeah, to shrink it so you can ship it more efficiently.
So, will this mean cheaper power?
I would say, if you look at the totality of it, right? I always say that I've heard this also from somebody else, but the most expensive electricity is the one that you don't have, right? But if you look at the whole totality of the system, I would say it is, right? I would say it is. Mm-hmm. But as I've said, you have to look at the whole system, meaning including coal, gas, and renewables. Because using LNG to power by itself is still not efficient, right? You have to have a portfolio.
It's a combination. And unlike other aging countries, our population continues to grow, which means the demand for energy is still going up.
Exactly. And that's the Philippine context, right? We we need to grow our economy, and we need more electricity capacity of electric generation to fuel that growth. It's economic growth runs in parallel with the growth in capacity.
So what do you need from government, from world leaders today to make this push easier and faster?
So I'll start with the rest of the world, the bigger countries. I think they really have to support the developing countries in terms of making sure that financing is available across all our power projects, right? So financing, availability of cheaper financing for us to...
Is it hard today?
There are challenges, especially if you're building a thermal, no? Relative to to renewables, right? So financing, insurance, those are two cost drivers, right? You understand that that there is a push for green resources, and sometimes that makes it difficult for thermal projects to get financing, right? So, but for a country like us, where we need cheap thermal baseload plants, we need that financing cost also to be available and competitive. And that goes with insurance as well. Now, for the country, it's more of giving clearer directions to the private developers on the future, right? About the future demand of, or rather, the future energy mix that is good for the country, so that the developers and investors can plan accordingly. And the policies should also match that direction, right? So that we can march together as an industry to support the Philippine government. And obviously there will be changes, right? And everybody has to be agile to move. But what remains to be true is that we need to make sure that the direction should be delivering electricity the most secure way, most reliable way, and of course, most sustainable way, right? So those are the three musts that we need to do for the country.
Of course, JERA is the largest power generating company in Japan, generating around 30% of domestic electricity. It is also the largest carbon dioxide emitter company in Japan. Lots of things to learn from the company.